Cool. All right. We're going to go ahead and get started. First of all, I want to introduce some of our staff people, my cohorts, and thank you all so much for wanting to be a part of the Neighborhood Advisory Boards. This is a new day, and I've been a liaison for 16 years about, and I am really, really excited about this new process. We're enthused, and council is interested, and they really want to hear from you and empower you to make a difference in your neighborhoods and your communities. So it's going to be an exciting time, and I thank you for your time and your efforts moving forward. Speaking of time, I want to be very respectful of that. So we are here for 2 hours, 5:30 to 7:30. We'll have questions. We can, I'm sure, you know, if you raise a hand, if you have an immediate question, we can stop. But we do have a question and answer session at the end. Because this is a public hearing meeting, not hearing, we will do public comment as well. If there's something that you want to take 3 minutes on that does not relate to NAB training, you can speak and fill out a public comment form. So let me first introduce the people that are here today from the city of Reno. We have Callie Wilsey, community liaison. Cynthia Esparza Trigueros, also community liaison. Did I say it right?
Yes.
Awesome. And Julie Teller, she's with she's our deputy city attorney from the city attorney's office. And again, my name is Barbara DiCiano. Is there anyone who would like to speak during public comment for something that's not related to the agenda? Cool. All right. We're going to get rolling then. I need to run over here. Have a little more intimate lighting for us. So we're going to start out with the purpose of the NAB. And both Callie and Cynthia and I are going to address this. I'm going to give you a little bit of background. As I said, we've had NABs in the past. They were in the wards. They were split by different geographical areas in those wards. And they were much more presentation based and not as much engagement and project identification. This will again be much more of getting your input and letting you be a part of improvement projects that we have. In the past, we had developers ask us if they could come to the Neighborhood Advisory Board on a related development project. And we had to leave it to that, to them requesting, because it's not a requirement that they come to the NABs. This will be different. We will have everything that's on a development review memo, which we'll cover more tomorrow, is coming to either the Planning Commission or the Council for a master plan amendment, special use permit, things like that. We will have planning staff there to give you just the facts of the case. And we will invite the development, the developers to attend as well so they can also give you information. But either way, you're going to get city information on the projects that are coming forward to the Planning Commission or the council member. And that's a big change. So that's a great point for you to attend all the meetings and be engaged. So with that, we took a hiatus from the NABs for maybe 16 months or so, pulled back, tried some different tools of engagement, and we ramped up our social media and did a lot of things that will help, but we definitely heard that we want our NABs back. It's a standard, regular place every month that you can go. You know where you're going to be, the time, who the players are, and you know that you'll see your council person, and the liaisons, which is totally cool. So, and you'll be able to, that will always be a venue for you to discuss issues and ideas. So much more solution-based, not, you know, we will definitely hear, oh, there's a cat that's whining in the side yard and my neighbors won't help. But we'll take those, but we'll also take solution-oriented suggestions, like I have an idea for the cats that are complaining in other people's yards. So with that, I'm not going to ramble anymore because I tend to, and I'm going to hand it over to Cynthia, who is going to talk a little bit more.
Good afternoon. I, like Barbara said, my name is Cynthia, and I'll be working closely with the Neighborhood Advisory Board in Ward 3. I've met a few of you in Ward 5 as well. So many of you probably received an email from me a few weeks ago. But what I really want to touch on is the importance of early engagement and the role that these boards play in the big scheme of things. And in the resolution, which you all have, and we'll look into that a little bit further on today, the boards themselves are a supplemental space for public comment. It's a forum within your neighborhood where you all are familiar with what's around, what issues are happening perhaps, what projects could be in place. So the board itself, I mean, it's a forum for you to come together as a community, look at potential projects, and also, I mean, have a voice in the bigger scheme of things. And I do want to touch on the fact that just as an example, a few years ago, there was, I think it was Ward 5, if I'm not mistaken, there was an issue with a lot of homes getting nuisance complaints, right? That developed into a city ordinance. And now there's an ordinance in place where if a home is receiving a lot of nuisance complaints and perhaps the individuals that live there are renters, rather than contacting the people that are renting the home various times and not getting a response, now that goes directly to the property owner after it occurs several times. And it goes directly through code enforcement, which is incredibly important because we want to ensure that we're contacting the correct individuals. And I'm seeing a head nod over there. So that's one example. Another example, just with public forum itself, recently there was an individual in our community who came to city council and was talking about pesticides in parks. That has now been further extended into an L item, which the city council assigns additional time to, where, correct me if I'm wrong, they will further assess the issue, and now Parks and Recs is involved, and there's the possibility of having parks within your individual wards potentially to be pesticides free. So just know that while it's a space where you all come together, your ability to have these dialogues is incredibly important in the bigger picture of not just your ward, but the community as a whole. And I think that covers my topic before I continue talking. So thank you.
Hi, everybody. I'm Callie. I'll be working directly with Wards 1 and Ward 2, and I'm really excited to get started on this process. So I'm just kind of covering the last two bullet points up there a little bit. But so one of the other purposes of the NAB is these development projects, right? So there are a lot of development projects that are proposed to the city, and we're looking for citizen impact or feedback on those. And what do you think about those, and what types of things can we ask of developers and work with them to make those successful in your neighborhoods. We're really going to go into depth in this part of the process tomorrow because there's a lot of details to it, but that's one of the things that you're going to see on a lot of your agenda items. Every month we come out with new proposals that are coming in, and we bring those to you guys, and then all that feedback will have a form that you can fill out at the meeting as well as online. So I know for me, sometimes it takes me a few days to kind of think about that information and then before I want to provide my feedback. So we're going to be having an online form as well for you to provide feedback. That information then goes to the Planning Commission as it works its way up the process. So it's kind of the you guys are the starting point and really helping to drive some feedback and what we can do to work with all of the developers in our community. One of the last pieces of the NABs that we are really focusing on this year is action-driven plans and projects in your community. So what we're asking for is our NABs to really brainstorm ideas of improvement projects that you want to see. What's going to make your neighborhood better? What's going to make your ward better? And we want to figure out a plan together on how to make those happen. So that's really going to be something that we're going to ask the NABs to come together on in every ward, and we'll be kind of focusing on that from the get-go. So that is overall the purpose of the NABs. There's a lot of information in your packets that we won't necessarily go over tonight, but feel free to look through that. And if you ever have any questions, let us know. I think that's it before I turn it over to Julie. Do you have anything else?
Actually, I have just one thing. This is
just my own little story that epitomizes citizen engagement, and it just happened, and I'm so excited. A gentleman in Ward 4 called for Councilmember McKenzie, and I spoke with him at length, and he was upset with a lot of things, some we could help with, some we couldn't. And one of his complaints was that there's street sweepers that come down our street and they go around abandoned cars. Why can't they do something about it instead of just drive by? So I thought, that's a good idea. So I checked with Public Works, and they thought, well, that is a good idea. So they, starting this week, this was just a call last week, they initiated a process where they have a form in every one of their field service vehicles and their street sweepers. When they see a possible code violation, they're going to write it down, and they're going to submit it at the end of their shift to the Public Works Department. And that was just a phone call from a citizen. So that is what is so exciting about you guys. And thank you. Okay, I'm done. Julie Teller, ta-da-da-da-da, City Attorney's Office.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Julie Teller, and I'm a Deputy City Attorney. It's nice to see so many familiar faces in the audience. Show of hands, how many of you are familiar with the open meeting law? Lot of you. That's so great. So my presentation today is going to be about the legal issues that you all will be dealing with as a NAB member. So to kind of start at the beginning, the intent of the open meeting law, which is you'll find in Nevada Revised Statute Chapter 241, basically the intent is up there, but basically it's for transparency. That the people's business is conducted in a public forum where deliberation and decisions are made for everyone to see. And then the second bullet point there is discussing if you're unavailable to attend in person, that teleconference or video conference is permissible to attend, just as long as everybody can hear you. Oh, and if at any time you have any questions, please feel free to raise your hand. I realize that the law is not the most exciting topic on this, on getting down and making decisions at the NABs, but I'm happy to answer any questions. And if you think of ones later on, or you go home and you think of, you can always contact me, and my contact information is at the end of the presentation. So the agenda. Basically, city staff will prepare the agenda for the NAB meeting. An action, meaning to deny or accept an item, may only be taken on an agenda item that is designated for possible action on the agenda. So if it doesn't have the word for possible action, you can't take action. Discussion must be limited to the scope of the agenda item. If it's about a development project, and that's the time it's being heard on the agenda, you can't jump to the next agenda item until everything's been discussed on the development item. There will be an agenda item entitled Identification of NAB Member Items for Future Agendas of the NAB, which is where you would say, I want to talk about this at the next agenda meeting. So it allows you to bring up items as well.
Does that include action items?
It can include action items, yes. taking action on an item. To take formal action, which would be to recommend or deny, a quorum must be present at the meeting. And a quorum is a majority of members who have been appointed. So let's say there's 7 members on your NAB and 5 members are there, you have a quorum. But if you have 7 members on your NAB and only 3 people are there, you do not have a quorum. A NAB cannot take formal action to recommend or deny a physical development project. And that was in City Resolution 8064. Basically, for physical development projects, council determined that everyone would just provide feedback and the minutes and everything would be forwarded on to the Planning Commission. So further taking action, continued, if there's no quorum, then the NAB may discuss the agenda items, but you can't vote to approve or deny. So even if it says 4 possible action on the agenda, if there's no quorum, you have 3 members there, only 7 were appointed, you can only discuss it. You can't recommend or deny. Items that you will see on the agenda, city budget, traffic, and all other programs and activities where citizen participation is desirable to improve the quality of life of all residents. And that's in Resolution 8064. Public comment. This is one of the more exciting times of the agenda, I think. You'll get a lot of feedback. Probably you'll have citizens of your wards coming and wanting to discuss various items, kind of the items that Barbara mentioned, you know, the project with the car and public works. It will be on the agenda at the beginning of the meeting and the end, and that's required by NRS 241020 subsection D3. The law is written in a way in which it either is taken beginning and the end or on every action item. So our office is recommending that because the NABs are serving a supplemental public comment, that in addition to taking public comment at the beginning and the end, that there also be public comment on any action item. And that public comment on any item needs to be done before the action is taken. If it's done after, it's futile. Public comment may not be restricted based on a speaker's viewpoint, i.e. interrupting the speaker and ending a speaker's public comment prior to the allotted time, which is generally 3 minutes, due to a disagreement of opinion or based on the content of what they're saying. Other open, oh, yes. You can't shorten it. I mean, let me take a step back. The city generally has public comment. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Okay, sorry, I thought my mic went out. The city basically generally has 3 minutes for everybody. If you restrict the time limit for public comment, it has to be restricted for everyone. You can allow somebody to finish their thought or a sentence. I know that that's what council does when the 3 minutes are up. Generally speaking, council does not allow people to combine their public comments to people coming to speak for 6 minutes. There are a lot of nuances about that if you want to discuss all that. But that's generally what council does. Yes.
Who might be in charge of an AB meeting to keep track of the time?
You know, that's a great question. It looks like Callie will be, the liaison, yeah.
It will be the liaison and the chairperson, possibly.
Okay, so the liaison and the chairperson, yes. Yes, we're going to discuss that later. I have a handout on that, too. All righty. So, other open meeting law provisions that doesn't necessarily concern you, but I think you should probably know about it. The agenda must be posted by 9 a.m. of the third working day prior to the meeting. Once this time has passed, no items may be added to the agenda. And again, that's for purposes of transparency, so the public can anticipate what you're going to be discussing and what you're going to be taking action on. Items, however, may be taken off the agenda after it's been posted. Something happens, somebody can't appear to make a presentation. That item can be taken off. It just, nothing can be added. And the minutes of the NAB meetings are public records and are subject to inspection by any member of the public.
Who has authority to take an item?
I'm sorry?
Who has authority to take an item off?
That's a good question. You know, I don't know that we've... I think it would be if somebody, if a NAB member wants to take an item off, I think that the NAB member should consult city staff, the liaison, possibly the council member of the NAB, to discuss kind of the reasons for taking an item off. That would be generally what I would say. Yes. Yes, I think yes. Well, we'll talk. Yes, it's on the chart that I have in the packet on Robert's Rules. Anything? I thought I saw a hand over here. No? No? Okay. All righty. And then finally, the last slide on open meeting law. This has to do with proxy. So you as a NAB member may not designate someone to attend a NAB meeting in your place. You can't say, hey, I want this person to attend for me. Cannot be done. And that's according to the law. The NAB itself cannot designate someone to attend a NAB meeting in someone else's place either, as a body. Any other questions about open meeting law before I go on to rules of ethics? Yes. That's a very good question. I don't think so.
Okay.
One member has one vote.
Okay.
No. Yes.
This isn't about open meeting laws. I think earlier that's still troubling me that the NAB cannot take formal action to recommend or deny the school development project. So we're just collecting input?
Yes.
We're not supposed to comment on it at all?
You can comment on it. You can comment on it. All, yes. So that's. Right, right. You have in the within the resolution, there's no authority to allow the NAB to make a formal vote on a physical development project. You're just supposed to collect all of the public comments, and you as NAB members can comment on it. And then all of that is forwarded on to the Planning Commission. Yeah.
Just to add a little bit to that. Everyone, the NAB members and the audience members and anyone can fill out the project review form. And at this level, it's more important to get your perspective on the impacts of whatever project it is, residential, traffic, whatever. When it gets to the Planning Commission, there and the City Council, they're confined to findings that they have to review every project on. So a vote by a NAB, we approve it or don't approve it, isn't as meaningful as the specifics that you can provide from a neighborhood perspective on the impact of that development. Does that make sense? Okay.
Thank you, Barbara. Yeah. Yes. A land project.
So something that comes in for a special use permit, the things that we in the NAB formerly used to the gate or NAB.
Correct. Correct. You just collect comments. Yes.
Yeah, I just wanted to do a vote of confidence for findings. Findings are really, really cool. Because it's really when City Council looks at something, they have to look at a specific list that's written out. And we can add to what that list that they have to make their judgment based on.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that, so it's in a way more powerful because we're not just saying yes or no based on our feelings, but they have to see the reason and then make the finding. Right.
Yeah.
Well, we as individual NAB members can have fill out these forms.
Yes.
So.
Yes.
Okay.
Very good point. Thank you. Anything else on open meeting law? You can always come back to it, but I just thought I'd ask one more time. Good? Okay. Code of ethics. Ooh, this is good stuff. So, at any time, the Reno Municipal Code, I don't know how many of you know that it's online or you can get it in the clerk's office, but all of these rules and are in Reno Municipal Code, and it's chapter 220. So this is going to sound like a lot of legalese to you. I'm going to try and make it as simple as I can. So the Code of Ethics, the intent of it is to preserve integrity, honesty, and fairness. Private financial dealings of governmental representatives present no conflict of interest between public trust and private gain. That's what we're trying to get to. And it's really important that there's public confidence in government at all levels. This also goes to transparency. So, application to the NAB members. Where do you all fit in? NAB members are considered to be public appointees, and you are defined as any person appointed by a public officer, in this case, the mayor and city council members, to serve on any board, agency, or commission charged with the responsibility of advising, recommending, or setting policy. And as the word, the second letter in NAB, you're advising the city. And that's why you're considered to be a public appointee. Resolution 8077 specifies that RMC chapter 220 applies to your actions as NAB members. So here's the part where we kind of go over a lot of legalese. General requirements, and all this can be found in 220.130. You cannot seek or accept a gift, which is defined as in excess of $100 and excludes family member gifts. Service, favor, employment, engagement, emolument, I don't know if I pronounced that word right, or economic opportunity that would improperly influence a reasonable person in his or her position to depart from the faithful and impartial discharge of your public duties. So basically, whether you can't receive a benefit that would change your mind. The second one, you cannot use your position as a NAB member to secure or grant unwarranted privileges, preferences, exemptions, or advantages for yourself, any family member, any business entity, or any other person. And family members are defined as all of those people down below. The next slide has number 3 and 4 on it. You may not participate as an agent of the government in negotiation or execution of a contract between the city and any person or business entity that has a self-interest, have an interest in. You may not accept any salary, retainer, gift, augmentation, expense allowance, or any other compensation from any private source for the performance of your public duties. Basically, you can't receive a benefit from somebody if you vote yes, I'll give you this kind of a situation. Any questions so far? Good. Number 5 and number 6. So number 5, if you acquire information by law, which is not at the time available to people generally, so you acquire information as a NAB member, somebody tells you something that just isn't in the press right now or most people don't know about, you can't use it to further your own interest or any other person that's connected to you or business entity. You cannot suppress any governmental report or other document because it affects your interest unfavorably. So an example of which, let's say you realize you probably said something inappropriate. You we all have those moments where maybe you could have said something differently during a NAB meeting, and somebody asks you for the records of the minutes. Because they're considered to be a public document, you have to give those over, even though you might not like how something was characterized in the minutes. Does that make sense? Okay. Not saying it's going to happen. I'm just giving you an example. And you cannot use governmental time, property, equipment, or any or other facility for a non-governmental purpose or to benefit your own interests. And there are exceptions, limited use of governmental property if four conditions are met, and we won't go over those. Information is available to members of the general public, or there's no special charge like using the telephone. Number 8 does not apply to a public appointee. Yay, something you don't need to be concerned about. You cannot seek other employment or contracts through the use of your position as an AB member. You cannot receive or acquire an interest in or an interest affected by a contract, transaction, land use decision, or other matter at a time when you know the interest will be directly affected by an official act or city action. So this goes back to the voting. How many of you are familiar or have seen boards or commissions make a disclaimer prior to voting on an issue? Some of you? Okay. And this is kind of what this is all about. This has to do with how your current interests would affect your voting. So RMC section 220.140 talks about how you vote on something when certain things are met. So you may vote on a matter if the benefit or the detriment accruing to you as a result of the decision, either individually or in representative capacity as a member of the general business profession, occupation, or group, is not greater than that accruing to any other member of the general business profession, occupation, or group. That sounds like a lot of legal mumbo jumbo, huh? Basically, you can't, if you're in a group of people, you can't vote on something that you would be specifically affected more, you'd have more of a benefit or more of a detriment than to the other group of people that you would be associated with. Does that make sense? Okay. Just not land development. You will be voting on other things, though. But there are exceptions to this rule, as in the cases in a lot of law. So the exceptions, you cannot approve, disapprove, vote, abstain from voting, or otherwise act upon a matter when you have accepted a gift or a loan related to that matter. You decide that you're reasonably affected by a commitment in a private capacity or to the interests of others, or when you have a pecuniary interest without disclosing the nature and extent of the gift, loan, commitment, or interest. Disclosure must be made at the time the matter is considered. Excuse me. That was going back to my original question, how many of you have seen a disclosure? And that's kind of, you can vote on it as long as you make the disclosure. And if you ever have a question about that, I am more than happy to answer that for you. And I can put together a disclosure form for you as well. Yes. Okay.
If I'm understanding that screen right, so something that I am involved with is being talked about in the NAB, and I disclose, but I can't, if there is a vote, which there should probably isn't, but if there is, I can't abstain from the vote?
So you would vote on it if you believe that the relationship that creates the conflict of interest doesn't have an impact on your ability to vote yes or no. Does that make sense? And if that's the case, then you would still have to disclose all of that.
I'm not exactly sure that's what that says behind you. I'm just trying to make sure.
Yeah, please do, Barbara.
My preference would be to abstain. Disclose for sure.
And
my preference would be if there was any question in my mind of how the appearance would look, just go ahead and abstain from.
And that's absolutely, you're right.
But it says cannot send a candidate to abstain. That's what's confusing.
It's because the disclosure part is an exception to an exception. So in number 3, I know, right? So if you have a pecuniary interest, you can't vote without disclosing the conflict. Does that make sense? You can't do anything without disclosing the conflict.
Well, yeah.
Okay, so you have to disclose the conflict, and then you can vote. If you believe that a normal person in your circumstances wouldn't be impacted by the relationship. Okay. Does that make sense?
It does make sense. It just doesn't work like
I know. Did you?
No, go ahead.
Okay. If you ever, like I said, if you ever have a question, please feel free to call me.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay? Yes, I see two, but I don't know who went first, so let's see you. It would depend on your personal, well, that's a very good question. If you have a true conflict that makes you think that it would impact your vote, then you probably shouldn't be part of the discussion either.
And I understand that, but, you know, okay, I'll discuss it, whatever, not even vote.
Yeah, right, that's a good point. Yeah, you had a question?
I was just curious. I possibly have the same situation. Can we come to you privately and say, this is my situation? Is this possible?
Absolutely.
Can I get some real, true feedback there?
Absolutely. Because this area of the law is so, there's a lot of exceptions, as we just discussed, it would be better if I had a specific instance and I could tell you what to do. Okay? Yeah.
So if there is a case where a development project is coming into your ward or surrounding areas and you have a concern about that, you can certainly be part of the discussion. You can provide input because that's what we're looking for. It would be more of if we were doing a cleanup project and you were the owner or your brother owned waste management and we were paying for bins, that would be a conflict. But if it's regarding development, we want that input. Does that help?
No.
Okay. Yeah. Hi. Sad question over in this area. Yes.
So this kind of affects the FEMA as well, because sometimes when you have those discussions with more than one person, it's not quite official.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So if we have questions for you regarding whether or not there's a conflict of interest, if it's between just two people one-on-one, you don't have to be under the provisions of what we
need. It's a very good question. consultations with an attorney in regarding disclosure of an ethical issue is not subject to the open meeting law. Yes.
Is it subject to confidentiality?
Yes and no. Standard lawyer answer, right? Yeah, I know, right. Yes and no. If there is an ethical, it's better to ask for permission than to ask for forgiveness, right? I see a no. If there is an ethical issue, and I'm going to get to it on the slide, if there's an ethical issue that requires an investigation, our office is the one to do the investigation. So if you come to me first and say, I want to vote on this, but I have this issue, can you help me draw up a disclosure statement, I'm happy to do that. And you can say on the record, in consultation with the city attorney's office, I discussed this issue with them and this is my disclosure. So you kind of have to say a little bit in the public, and some of it may not remain private, because if there's truly an issue, if there's truly an ethical investigation going on, I don't know the confidentiality of it, because it goes to the Ethics Commission and they investigate, and then sometimes they issue public opinions, sometimes they issue private opinions. So I hope that answers your question. It depends a lot on the situation. Okay. Any other before I go on? Okay, and back to what I was going to mention, the role of the city attorney's office. The city attorney's office issues advisory formal opinions. We may also refer the matter to the State Ethics Commission. That's what I was kind of talking about earlier. The district attorney's office or outside counsel. Opinions are binding until amended or revoked, and there's a good faith action. So as long as you follow the opinion in good faith, you're okay. Enforcement, the city attorney's office also enforces Chapter 220. We investigate, initiate corrective action, and recommend any appropriate action. More about what the city attorney's office does. City council may direct the office to investigate, prosecute through our office any apparent violation of the chapter, or council may employ or appoint a qualified attorney to investigate or prosecute the violation. A complaint may be filed by any person who believes there to be a violation, so any member of the public. And so the violation and the penalty. Any public appointee who willfully and knowingly violates this chapter shall be subject to immediate removal by his or her appointing officer. So in this case, I don't know how many of you are aware, but council has designated authority to remove you from the NAB by the council member who sits on the NAB. Any questions about ethics before I go on to Robert's Rules of Order? None? Aren't you guys jazzed about the law? Yeah? I'm jazzed about NABs. I really am. So, Robert's Rules of Order, and my understanding is you have a handout. And that, so, really, Robert's Rules of Order is a thick book. And so, I decided to find a chart that's kind of abbreviated so you didn't have to look at the book. But you're more than welcome to look at the book if you want more information. But this is how the chart's organized. So you'll see on the first page, main motions. These motions are listed in order of precedence. A motion can be introduced if it's higher on the chart than the pending motion. So you'll look at the first one listed. To close a meeting is a higher precedence than the other ones. So you can close a meeting pretty quick. So what you say, I move to adjourn, whether it can be interrupted by anybody, and the answer is no. Whether it requires a second is the next column, and that's a yes. Debate, there's no debating allowed. Can you amend? No. And what's the vote required? A majority. So I was kind of looking at this and thinking of all the ones that maybe you all would need. And I think probably to close a meeting, you would need to take a break. If you have a particularly long NAB, you might want to take a break. And that's the next one. 18, make follow the agenda. That's kind of one where a member can call if they feel as though the open meeting law is not being complied with, like you're going off the agenda topic. I call for orders of the day. No second is required and no vote is actually even required. So you just pretty much need to shout it. Page 2, incidental motions, you'll see that it's no order of precedence. These motions arise incidentally and decided immediately. And again, I was thinking of ones that you would probably use. Probably Section 23, enforce the rules, point of order. Probably to divide a motion. Sometimes motions have lots of parts to them. So it might be that you like one part and not the other, and you want to divide it. Demanding a rising vote. Now, I thought this was kind of interesting. I looked at this chart and I'm like, what is a rising vote? It's when you ask for everybody to rise in an affirmance of the issue because you want to see who's voting for it. Isn't that interesting? I thought it was. Maybe. So, anyway, and then motions that bring a question again before this assembly, that's if you go back, take matter from the table. I think that was kind of what you were talking about earlier with taking an item off the agenda. Motion to reconsider. If for some reason something isn't clear from a previous motion and you decide, well, maybe we should reconsider it. We should go back and fix it. So there's a clear record. Our comments are heard. You know, you can do that. So, any questions? Yes. Yes, it has to be agendized though. So it has to be, so I think I understand what you're saying. You make a motion on a meeting that happens in August. You want to talk again about that issue in September. It has to be on the September's agenda though. Yes. Yes, absolutely. As long as it's on the agenda, you're good to go. Yes. 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 Correct. If you move to continue it to the next meeting, yes, it will be on the next agenda. Or if you want it on in an agenda in 2 months from now, you can do that too, or three, you know. Yes. Ooh, serial meetings. Yeah. It depends on the situation, but generally speaking, if you're gathering together and you're voting to approve or deny something and you have a quorum, it has to be, have an agenda, properly noticed, posted, on and on and on and on. If you're just at a social gathering and you're not meeting to discuss items, I believe I could check back with you on this, but there is an open meeting law manual on the Attorney General's website if you ever have any questions, and there is a section on serial meetings, and that's what you're asking. If you happen to have a quorum at a social event, there's a situation I think discussed on that, and I can't remember off the top of my head, but I can get your name and number and I can respond back to you, or
no,
you...
I'm pretty super familiar. I used to run a governor's task force.
Oh, great. Right. Yes. That is a very good point. Because if you're talking about an agenda item over email, you're deliberating outside the general public. You stop discussions over email and you agendize it for a meeting. Yeah, like I said, the Attorney General's office, they're the ones that enforce the open meeting law. They're the ones that put out a manual and provide regular updates as the law changes. Yes?
What if somebody wants technical assistance accessing public records, for example? It's like if somebody wanted help researching a public records question, could they ask me for that information and I send it to them?
Yeah, is it?
Yeah, it's another NAB member. So if somebody asked me, let's see, would be a good example, maybe a research question about the number of owners in a neighborhood, just make something random, or where all the parks are, just something random.
Generally speaking, all of our public records requests go through the city clerk's office. So I would advise you to tell whoever made that request to go through the city clerk's office. There is a form, I believe, online. Yes? Yes.
So, you know, if the NABs are looking for information on something that we can bring forward, then we can do some of that research and, you know, get it through city staff and get it to you guys.
So I know I'm poking a little bit more. So
that's okay.
If somebody asked me a question, could I come up with the answer and then post it publicly as a more organized link to public records rather than just, you know, a hard to read PDF or... I know the formatting that I can do tends to be a lot better and more usable.
So you're talking about taking a public record and reformatting it so that it's more readable?
Right.
Okay. I know we generally speaking, we haven't talked about public records, but generally speaking, there's no duty under the law to create a new record to respond to a records request. All the duty that's there is to give over what we currently have.
Yeah. So if I voluntarily do that and post it publicly, I mean, is that a good way to approach that?
I think it would depend on the document.
Where are you thinking you would post it?
Yeah, because...
online, either on the Facebook group or where...
Okay. I guess, yeah, it would depend. It would depend. But it would become a public record.
Correct.
Yes. Okay.
I think it would be better, and I understand because of your ability to query information, it would be better if there's a question for... help with pulling information or research, that it be discussed at the NAB meeting so that everyone is privy to the same information. Because what could happen is you could share it with Joe, who's also on the NAB board, and then Joe could share it with Sally, who's also on the NAB board, and then it goes on, and it becomes a serial meeting. So...
I mean, if they were adding their opinions about a specific project, that would be obvious. But if they weren't.
Right. That would be my suggestion. Just be, if it's a citizen who's just asking for information, that's a different thing. But if it's an appointed board member, then you could run afoul of the open meeting law.
So I've got a third one.
Go for it.
Go for it.
They might ask me, can I do it, send it to the clerk, and then have the clerk send it, review it, or is that going to just take too long, or be a burden on staff?
I think that would be a question for the clerk, whether she'd want to do that. Or the liaison, yeah. Well, it's ultimately the clerk who'd be doing it, so she would have to, I'd have to discuss it with her.
Okay, thanks for the indulgence.
Yeah, no problem. Yes. Yes.
And would you prefer that NAB members not attend the city council meeting or make public comment during city council outside of the NAB? Or
That's a Barbara question.
And that's a great question, and it's part of the handout that we provided. But you are a citizen, first and foremost. You are absolutely able to attend planning commissions, city council meetings, speak during public comment. What you will not be doing is representing the perspective of the NAB. You are an individual citizen. So there will be, other than the liaisons and the council, sharing the information, there isn't a formal NAB spokesperson. So absolutely still stay involved in all of those things. That would be great. It would be, I'm a NAB member on the Ward 2 NAB, but I'm speaking as a private citizen. Yep. Good question.
Yes. Right here in front.
It seems to me they're all the same thing. And then selection of public records and posting, selection of particular records could itself be supporting a position.
Very good.
To choose to select or not select.
Very good points. I think generally speaking, when you look at it, okay, so in an email, you can exclude others, right, by not sending it to certain people. Not everybody has the internet. Not everybody has access to the blogs. Not everyone has access to a Facebook page. So I would say to truly deliberate with transparency, it needs to be done at a meeting. That's the safest. Anyone else? Okay. We're going to talk about some more slides, and I'll turn it over to these wonderful women. But my contact information is at the end. Again, feel free to contact me via email, via phone. My direct line is on the last slide if you ever have any questions. Okay? Thanks.
I feel so short when I have to push this down every single time. We're just going to go through briefly the NAP structure, and we're going to be referencing the resolution, the enacting resolution, that sets forth how the NAB is structured and what your parameters are. In the past, we had bylaws. We have done away with those, and we've included everything in this resolution. And the first part of it is, again, just the reference to the past resolutions. There must be like 20 resolutions, naming them district councils, naming them NAB boards, and then all different kinds of things. So this just references that part of it. The second part is, I have to put my glasses on, sorry, is actually rescinding all those and creating this new neighborhood advisory board and the structure, which is different than the past neighborhood advisory boards. So I just wanted to give you that little tiny background. I'm going to turn it over to Cynthia, who's going to give you some details as to the structure.
All right. So I just have to start by saying that March 11th was a great day because that was when the NABs were formally reintroduced, and now you all are here, so exciting times. Yay! And, you know, just to reiterate what I said earlier, the boards themselves are a forum and a supplemental space for public comment. Of course, you could still come to City Council, but it's an additional space in your neighborhoods. Something else to keep in mind is one of the big goals, which I feel like we've all kind of touched on, is we really want to improve communication, have those different avenues to communicate, and then have people that also have know other groups in the community who could potentially share information as well. So it's a trickle effect that we really want to accomplish in terms of communication. As far as the board structure itself, boards have up to 11 members. You don't need to have all 11, but that is the maximum number of members that could exist within a board. We do have 5 wards, so there are 5 neighborhood advisory boards. The meetings themselves, it's once a month, and you should have already received this information. They are set on specific days and times just to be consistent, and those are once a month. As far as terms, the term itself, it's for 2 years. A NAB member could serve a consecutive term. So that would result in 4 years of being a NAB member. After that, if you wanted to continue to be a member, you actually would need to have a year break before applying again. So it would be 4 years if, you know, you do 2 years, and if you want to do it again, you could apply. And if appointed, it would be an additional 2 years, and then a 1 year break, and then you could potentially reapply in the future. Any questions about that? Perfect. And just to touch on what Julie mentioned, very exciting open meeting law, that NRS statutes that we all must follow. So I'm sure by the end of your term, you will be experts. And something important to touch on as well is in the past, there had been a community pride grant that each board had access to based on population within the ward. That is no longer in place. There are donation funds that could be potentially utilized per council member, but it's a change from last time. So if we have members who were previously involved, just know that that's something that's different this time around. Something else, very important, because you all are a group of individuals who want to be involved, who are volunteering, who are being involved civically, you will potentially be reached out to by other departments to get additional feedback. So while we do have the structure and development plans that will be discussed, there may also be additional groups that want to reach out to get your perspectives, opinions, feedback on additional things that are going on within the city. Any questions? Sure. Public comment, potentially, or it could be an item.
If for each, the council member, I'm sorry, I'm getting my all my terms confused. The NAB will have a rotating chair. So the agenda is set by the chair, the council person, and the liaison. So if there is a request, it can come through as an agenda item, or someone can come to public comment and ask that it be put on an agenda for discussion, or if it's for a request from a NAB member, there is an item on each agenda for future agenda items. So there are several ways that you can identify things to put on an agenda. Yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. On the July council NAB meetings, we have a parks item for the pesticide free. So that's an example of a city department coming to the NABs. Okay.
Yeah. And along those same lines, when things like that do come up, keep in mind that public comment is 3 minutes, and if it's an important item that perhaps would require a little bit more time, that's something to keep in mind as well. Any other questions? Sure.
Do you have a property that's going to be considered? Are you going to zoning for that property?
Zoning for properties.
Anything that is related to a special use permit or a zoning amendment will go to the Neighborhood Advisory Board for input. If it's something that is, if it's a development project that is has the zoning and the entitlements already, then it doesn't need to go through any type of approval process at all, just a site plan review. So if it's a zoning request amendment, then yes, it would come to the NAB. Yes. We work from a document from Community Development called a Development Review Memo. And they put all of the application text in that memo, and we will copy it exactly over. And there are links online to the entire application package. So you will be able to review all of the information from the LDC number that's provided, and then from what the planner will be discussing at that NAB meeting. Oh, I'm sorry, Bill, let me make sure I get this right, that NABs will see zone change requests. Is that correct? I'm sorry, go ahead. So Mr. Thornton's question is, will we coordinate with the county assessor as far as property taxes go and the corresponding zoning? We do not coordinate with them. We will not be reviewing any type of tax impact. It's just the straightforward land use for that parcel.
Barbara, you were just talking about when the zone change is actually acted upon and the zoning is changed.
Thank you.
And I don't know if you know that answer.
I don't.
Yeah.
Do you know that answer?
I do not.
Okay.
I should know that answer. I mean, I think what technically has to happen is, you know, the city's, somebody at the city is supposed to let the county know that the zoning has changed in a specific piece of property. And how those two coordinate is something that the assessor's offices coordinate with. Because Washoe County maintains the assessor's parcel base for the entire county.
Right, right.
And
so, Jay, go ahead.
Individual micro neighborhoods also have an appointed person in the assessor's office to take care of that. They might not always keep up, so if that's an issue in a specific neighborhood, we would know who is responsible for that.
So I can check with our community development department. I'm sure they have a process for, after the fact, sending documents over. Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Can we anticipate or be prohibited from interacting with some county agencies as far as they want to talk to the neighborhoods?
Not at all. If you wanted a presentation on from the tax assessor on how the process works, we can certainly schedule something. That, again, would be an agenda item.
Yeah, but particularly on the tax assessment.
Anything.
Just in general?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. Carly?
You just mentioned that if there is a project, and I'm just simply asking this for my own purposes, if there's a project that there is no zoning change, they've got all their great, everything's in motion, they just need a site plan review, and they go and start working. They're not to be notified of that, but in my particular situation, I am asked from a lot of community members, what's going on?
Right.
Will we be getting a little bit of advice or guidance on how to disclose those upcoming projects?
Tomorrow night, you'll have a lot of the development questions answered. We get notice for site plan reviews, which is what happens when they have all the entitlements. The timing is different. It's a 30-day process. So we might not be able to get it to the NAB for actual discussion. It might be just an advisory that this has come up. The site plan went through, but there won't be time for input.
Perfect. All right. And then just to touch on one last thing, every month there will be a different chairperson for the NABs. So that's just something else to keep in mind as well. And I think that wraps up my section. And like, Callie, take over. Oh, go ahead.
It would be the chair or the council.
Or the council, yeah.
If there's a NAB person that requests that an entire NAB meeting be canceled, it would need to go to the liaison through the chair. How about uncanceled?
We were just looking at there's some that are canceled.
Uncanceled.
We're gonna have one and then we're not gonna have one.
No, I pinky swear we're gonna meet more than you ever wanted to meet.
So
promise.
The chair or the council person, or do you want me to?
The liaison will take those requests. Are you talking about special meetings?
No.
Possibly?
Because
I can tell you why. Because we're meeting at the Reno Stead Airport, and the air races are that month, so they could not accommodate us. And Council Member McKenzie suggested that it be canceled. So, and I have looked for other sites, and I couldn't come up with one. So. If we can find a place that is of no cost, if you want to have it in chambers, we could certainly pursue that. And we can talk offline if you want.
All right. Callie.
All right, and I'm just going to wrap up with kind of going through the rest of the little the portions, but we've really hit on a lot of them because they're in the development portion of this resolution that we're walking through. But again, the NAB's not intended to replace the Planning Commission or the Board of Adjustment or the City Council, but your feedback is going to be taken into consideration as they do make those action items. So again, our community development folks are going to be here tomorrow, and we're really going to go through that process. Something else a little bit different for those who have been around for a while is, I think Barbara mentioned this at the beginning, but we are inviting the developers to come, but really the presentation about the facts will be provided by city staff in our planning department. And then the developers will also be there to hear your feedback, and we'll have those forms that we had previously discussed. I know there's a lot of questions on the development portion because there's a lot of intricacies in there, so that's why we're focusing an entire night to it. So, you know, we're happy to answer best we can tonight, but again, our community development folks will really be able to provide great answers tomorrow night as well. So then just the last thing I want to point out in our packet, it's coming right before that resolution that we're looking at, is an analytics plan. So, you know, we're really focused on making sure as we reinstate these NABs to make sure that we're really focusing on engagement and using some data to help us drive our improvement process. Us three are really focused on making sure that the process works for you, helps your neighborhood. So we're not looking to come in here, you know, with a strong arm and say, this is the way it's going to be. So we're looking for feedback. And so we're going to be really tracking some data about engagement, how people are engaging on our website or the Facebook group in the meeting in particular. How many people are actually submitting information on these project development review forms. So we're going to be tracking that on a monthly basis, and on quarterly we're also going to be sending out surveys to you because we want feedback on what we can do to help this process more. So as we're kind of going through this, you know, we're looking for that. Keep that in mind. It's a new process. While NABs have kind of been around for a while, we're shooting for a new direction. But we really want you guys to drive this and drive improvement in your neighborhood. So we'll be constantly asking for your feedback on what will make this process better, and we're looking to improve the whole time. So what we just put in there is our plan currently for what we're tracking. And if you're ever interested, you know, let us know. We're happy to share any of those numbers. So awesome. Yes.
Could you do any kind of a survey of us?
From the training?
Yeah, probably maybe during the training if you had time to put it together.
Yeah, we actually are planning on, so I think some of you know, because we can't be here, some people can't be here every night. We are taping these series, and all the materials are going to be online. So once those are up, we're going to send out a survey for everybody to kind of provide some feedback on these training sessions. Is there anything that we left off that you would still want more information on that we can bring back to the NABs? Is there, you know, what could we have done better, et cetera? So there is a survey in the works. We just want to provide it holistically after the three of them, because we might, you know, you might think that we're covering it today, but it's really coming up on Thursday or something like that. So we want to make sure we cover the training holistically.
And then beyond the training, could you add in some demographic questions or?
Like in the survey?
Yeah, in the survey. I just think that'd be useful information for the city to have, like who we are.
We're actually working on creating standard demographic questions that will be added in each survey. So we can probably incorporate those as well, asking for what ward you're in. We'll know because we know the community we're working with, but additional questions as well. So,
yeah.
I'd like to see a fiscal impact, you know, for these items that come up. You've got the items themselves, you've got the power for the board, you've got the legal counsel, you've got the fiscal counsel.
So the question is, you'd like to see the fiscal impact of each one of the actions taken? Okay. So I know that one of the things that you'll see in there that we are really holding ourselves strictly to is, let's say a development project comes to the NAB. We provide your feedback. It goes to the Planning Commission, then it goes to the City Council. We're going to be reporting that process back to everybody. So our goal is not for it to come into your hands and like disappears, right? Like we want you to know what feedback was used and why and what the end result was. So at any point, if there's, you know, we're reporting back and you have some additional questions, let us know if there's something specifically in that project that you're looking for, and we'll do our best to kind of dig it up. Anything else? All right. Want to close this up?
Great. Yeah.
Awesome. I have a second.
You guys are good.
Yeah, go ahead.
I would like to meet with the other NAB members that are in my NAB.
Okay.
Could you raise our hands or something?
Yeah, do. Can we just do that real fast? All right, so who's Ward 1? Yay! Ward 1! Who's Ward 2? Yay, Ward 2! Yay. We'll meet by that pillar, so we'll go Ward 1, Ward 2.
Ward 3?
Right.
Ward 4?
Yay!
Yay, Ward 5.
Oh, you guys rock.
Awesome. And our diligent city attorney reminded me that we need to take public comment. If there is anyone that would like to speak... Okay, cool. Thank you so much for your time. We will definitely, we've got till 7:30 if we can hang around and answer questions individually. If there's anything for the betterment of the group. Thank you. Yes.
When will the tapes be
available? After the sessions are complete. So, yeah, I would say next week. Okay? Thank you so much for your time.